Amen, amen. You may be seated. And as the choir comes down, wow. Looks like both these pastors today are getting a little emotional. I tell you, you think about all that God has done for us in His Son, Jesus Christ. This is a glorious day. Of course, every Sunday is like Easter. You know what? That's why Christians, that's our Sabbath. You know, the Christian Sabbath in the Old Testament was the seventh day. Christian Sabbath is the first day. That's why we worship on Sunday, is that's when Jesus rose from the dead. But thank you, choir. Thank you, musicians. And I know they put a lot of time and effort into that. I appreciate them. Let me just stop by saying thanks to a lot of folks. We had a great prayer drive-through and closing of the tomb on Friday. About 20 cars stopped by, and we had ministered to people here in our community. A lot of really tough issues in people's lives, things from alcoholism to all kinds of stuff, and we had a great time. I want to thank everybody who's been a part of that, the guys that come, you know, to close the tomb, and the guy that got up early this morning came back out there and opened it back up, you know. But it's been a great week. And now we come to Easter Sunday. Amazing Easter. That's the message today. You know, Easter Sunday, we have a choice, don't we? We have a choice to make. We can either be, like a lot of folks, be amused, or we can be amazed. And, you know, to be amused literally means to stop musing or thinking. It's often a pleasure sought to direct our attention away from something that's serious, you know. A lot of people don't want to think about Easter. They don't want to think about the fact that Jesus died, that he rose from the dead. They're amused. But to be amazed, on the other hand, means to be bewildered, to bring into amaze. In other words, amazement is the idea of being confounded or being so astonished that you don't even know what to say. You're just amazed. That's Easter. That God would love us so much that he would give up his only son. Think about that, folks, if you have children. I have four daughters. Would I give any of them up to die for any of you? No, I wouldn't. God gave his one and only. And he came and he lived a perfect life and he died that horrible death, and hallelujah, he rose. He is risen. Oh, y'all are with me. Y'all are awake. Amen. Well, it is so good. You know, John mentions this in John chapter 5, verse 24. He tells us that, you know, we ought to be amazed. The word can mean to be inspiring awe and wonder. Actually, the word amazed, and we talk about amazing Easter, it is in the Bible 39 times, and 37 times in the Bible. Of those 39 times, it's people who are, when they see Jesus, and they're in awe of him. And then the other two times that it's mentioned in the Bible, this word amazed, is Jesus is amazed. First time in Luke 7, verse 9, he's amazed at the high level of this man's faith, that he has such a big faith. And then the next time in Mark 6:6, he's amazed at a group of people because of their lack of faith. One time he's amazed at big faith, and the next time the lack of faith. But we're going to look at four of the main characters in the Easter drama this morning. Besides our Lord Jesus Christ, we're going to look at Mary Magdalene and John and Peter and Thomas. And this is found in the last two chapters of the Gospel of John. And each of them, I think, in their own way, experience what I want to call amazing Easter. And you may find yourself relating to either one of them or all four of them. The first one is Mary. You remember the story there. We find out that Mary, on that first Easter morning, she had her weakness wiped out. In the 20th chapter in verse 11, the scripture says this, "But Mary stood outside the tomb weeping, and as she wept, she stooped down and looked into the tomb." You know, there she was, standing outside of the empty tomb, crying. You know, she was filled, I believe, with a wide array of emotions. If you know the story about Mary Magdalene, She was the one that Jesus cast seven devils out of. All four Gospels, you know, list all different kinds of emotions around the crucifixion of Jesus and Easter. There's crying, there's people that are alarmed, there are people bewildered, there's joy, there's trembling, there's people who are afraid, there's weeping. And it says there she was standing there, and she bent over and she looked into the tomb, and the Bible says that she saw two angels in white seated. They weren't standing. You know, usually when you see angels in the Bible, they're standing, but these two angels were seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and one at the foot. That's in verse 15 here if you want to look in your Bible there. But so she stoops in and she sees these two angels. And then she turns around, and who's there? The risen Christ. Jesus is there, but she does not recognize him. This is something that puzzles me. Several of the appearances of Jesus that are recorded in the Bible, when Jesus appeared, they don't recognize him. I don't know what that really says, but you think about it. And so there she is, and he speaks these beautiful words of comfort. And he asks her two questions. Notice verse 15. Notice these questions in verse 15. It says she supposed him to be a gardener, so he said to her, "Sir, if you carried him away, tell me where." And Jesus said, "Mary." Mary. "Don't cling to me." Put yourself in her place this morning. Does Jesus rebuke her for crying and grieving? No, he doesn't. He gently invites her to talk about her sadness and her sorrow. You sad today? You sad on this Easter morning? You see, Jesus knows all about those things that make us sad. Hallelujah. He understands your fear. Afraid today? He understands your anxiety. You anxious today? The Lord Jesus Christ, the risen Christ, wants to walk through your life, your pain, with you. You see, Jesus not only asks about her sorrow, but he wants her to know about her seeking. Are you seeking the Lord today? If you're sorrowful, you see, he tenderly prods her. He says, he goes on to say, if you read the story, he says, "Who are you looking for?" Who are you looking for? Notice he didn't say, "What are you looking for?" He didn't say, "A lot of people are looking for what?" But they need to be looking for who. Who are you looking for? You see, until you find Jesus, until you find the risen Christ in your life, each of us is looking really for someone. Sadly to say, many people are searching for something, not someone. But I want to tell you that only Jesus Christ can meet the deepest need of a human being's heart. And people try to fill up that void with all kinds of stuff today. I want to tell you, it doesn't work. There's many people that could stand here and give testimony. You know, all kinds of things. Substance abuse. All different kinds of stuff. But only Jesus, only that someone, only Jesus himself can meet that need. Are you crying on the inside today, maybe not on the outside? Are you like Mary Magdalene, who, she had a messed up life. She had a mixed up life, but Jesus brought that chaos into order. You see, Jesus knows all about it. Whatever you're facing today, whatever's going on in your life today, let me tell you, Jesus knows all about it. Invite him into your life. Invite him into your pain, into your difficulty. Back again, let me just ask, who are you searching for today? If you're searching for Jesus, I want to tell you, you'll find him because he meets you right where you are. Look at that verse 16 again. What does Jesus say? Mary. Actually, the real translation is Miriam. Did you know the word Mary is more of a, English version of the Hebrew name Miriam. He spoke her special name. It's kind of like a nickname, you know. Some people have, he used that word. And then what does she do? She turns, it said, the Bible says she turns and says, Rabboni. Rabboni, that's a term of high respect. It literally meant my master, my teacher. In other words, the resurrected Christ is speaking her name. Let me tell you, he's speaking your name this morning. He's saying, Ron. Linda. Margaret. David. Randy. The Savior is here. Jesus says, when two or three are gathered in my name, what? I'm in your midst. He's here. You don't see him, but I want to tell you, he's speaking your name today. He's speaking your name just like he spoke his name, Mary's name. And so, do you hear him? Are you listening to him? Will you follow him? Are you surrendered to him? That's Mary. And then we come to this young disciple by the name of John. Mary's weakness was wiped away by her encounter with the risen Christ. But in John, we see that he believes and he receives. And so after Mary tells Peter, and she runs back and she tells Peter and John what had happened to her. And the Bible says here in John's gospel that they take off for the tomb. And the reason I say John is young, because what happens? He outruns Peter. And he gets there first. And he sprints. And he gets to the tomb. You know, have you ever noticed that there's a lot of running related to the resurrection? You read the stories in the gospel. There's a lot of running going on, Brother Cayman. So John gets there. You know, in other words, it's like they couldn't just sit still or walk, but they had to run. And so he arrives, and it says, the Bible says there, if you look at it, he bends over, and he looks into that tomb, to that empty tomb, that burial place, where he sees these strips of linen that were wrapped. The linen was wrapped up. It had been wrapped around the body of Jesus, but they saw folded. This linen was folded up, wrapped up. And eventually, we're told here that he went inside. And when he went inside the tomb, Brother Larry, and he looked around, here's what the Bible says, Brother Jim. He saw and believed. He believed that Jesus was alive. He saw and he believed. You know, there's three different words in this passage, verse 5 and verse 6 and verse 8. You know, in English, we only have one word to see. But in the Greek, it's a very intricate language. There's three different words in the original text here for see. The first word in verse 5 is to just like glance or just to look at something real quickly. And in verse 6, it literally means to look carefully at something, to really look at it carefully. But verse 8, the word for see there is a different word. It literally means to perceive with intellect or intelligent comprehension. To see something in such a way that you really see what it is and you understand it, you see. In other words, good old common Mississippi talk is the light went on. The light went on in his heart, and it says he saw, that's that word there, and believed. He believed in the resurrection. Do you believe in the resurrection today? Does that describe you today, that you see and you believe? Have you been thinking about spiritual matters? Has any of it been making any sense to you? Let me say today, if you haven't met Jesus, let me just urge you, just keep seeking and keep searching. And I want to tell you, if you really search with your heart, you'll eventually believe and you'll eventually receive the Lord Jesus into your heart. Just keep on. That's John. And then we come to Peter. Literally means rock, doesn't it? But remember what Peter had done? Before Jesus was crucified, we see here Peter gets the second chance. We serve a God of the second chance. A That's Peter's story. Have you ever stopped to think that Jesus knows everything about you and me and he still loves us? Not too many folks, if they knew everything about you or me, would love us. I mean, we're just, you know, all of us are messed up in our own way. Really. We're human beings. We're sinners. Folks, our culture has flipped the narrative, which is not true. Man is not good, naturally. Amen. Now, some men are better than others. Some people are gooder, I guess. That's not pretty good. Some people are gooder than others, but I mean, we're all sinners. The only way you can explain all of the evil and all of the bad things that are in this world is sin. We are human beings, have the capacity to do horrible things. Just turn on you, which don't turn on. I hate to turn on the news. I mean, and we sometimes act shocked at it. No, people are sinners. Without the restraining grace of the God and the Holy Spirit in our lives, any of us can do horrible things. Even a Christian, folks, we get away from the Lord. But thank God, He's the God of the second chance, and He does care deeply for you and for me, regardless of whatever we've done or ever how we're living. God loves you, folks. God loves you, no matter what you've done or how you're living. Let me tell you this morning, God loves you. God loves to fully restore fallen failures. That's what Peter was. You remember he denied Jesus three times. Of course, Jesus told him he was going to. He didn't believe. He said, before that cock crows, you're going to deny you even know me three times. And we know that's, the scripture says that's what happened. So many days after the resurrection, we come to John's Gospel, chapter 21, and Jesus is, his disciples are out there fishing. They, you know, they went back to fishing, Brother Jim. After Jesus died on the cross, they went back to fishing. They were out there fishing. And they looked up on the shore. John tells us here in John 21, if you look at it there, you get home this afternoon and look at it. And Jesus was grilling some fish. You know, over there in the Middle East and where we live for many years in the Philippines, we don't do that here in America, but they eat fish for breakfast. That's a very common food in the East. Now, I like fish, but I don't like to eat it for breakfast. But anyway, but here was Jesus on the shore. He was grilling some fish, the Bible says here. He was on the beach, and Peter comes to Jesus on the beach, the risen Lord, and they have a conversation. And after they have their breakfast, Jesus publicly forgives Peter, and he reinstates him. And you know, as Peter smells that charcoal fire, I believe, and the heat from that, I believe he's reminded of the fact that, you know, before Jesus was crucified, he was warming himself at the fire in that courtyard, and that's when he began his denial of Jesus. But Peter gets a fresh start. He's now free. And in the 15th, 16th, 17th verses of John there, I want to encourage you to look at that when you get home. There's some questions that are asked by Jesus, and they're all about Peter's love. And again, in the Greek language, did you know there's not just one word for love? And if you'll look at that closely, he talks about, Peter, do you love me? And that word for love is just like a brotherly love kind of thing. And then the second time, he asked him a second time. You know, remember, he denied him three times. So, do you love me? Do you love me just as a brother? Second one is, you know, that word there is like a friendly love. The second one. And then he asked him a third time, Brother Larry. And the third time he uses that word love, it's the agape. It's the God kind of love, self-sacrificing. He said, do you really love me? Like I love you, like God loves you. What we would say is unconditional love. Do you really love me? You see, his denials really had not disqualified him from service. Let me tell you this morning, have you failed? I have. Failure is not final, Brother John. Our God is a God of the second chance. We see this in Peter's life. No matter what we've done, you can be forgiven if you come to the Lord. The resurrection gives us hope. The resurrection gives us hope for healing. The resurrection of Jesus Christ this morning gives us hope of assurance that our sins have been washed away, have been forgiven, as we have sung about it. Think about this for a moment. The Lord knows every single thing about, every little secret you got. We all got secrets. We may not admit it. But did you know, even though he knows all that, he still loves you, Brother Jim. God so loved the world. That's the word agape. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. And then we come to Thomas. Oh, famous Thomas. Peter got second chance, but Thomas, you know, he had his doubt. His doubts were defeated. The disciples were gathered together, we're told, in the upper room on Easter Sunday night to receive peace and power in their lives, but someone wasn't there, Brother David. Now, we don't know why. The Bible doesn't tell us why. But Thomas, who was one of Jesus' 12 disciples, he was not there. He wasn't at church, as we would say. he wasn't there. We don't know why. But when he heard that they had been with Jesus, it's kind of like he crossed his arms. And if you look at verse 25 there, he said, he didn't believe it. He said, unless I see it and I take my finger and I put it into the scars in his hands, unless I put my fingers into his side where the soldier had put that spear to see if he was dead or alive, where the blood and water came out and showed that he was dead already. He said, unless I see it, unless I touch it, I'm not going to believe. But why wasn't he there that first night? You see, he missed seeing the Lord. You see, no matter how discouraged you are, you need to be with God's people in God's house when they meet, so you can hear what God has to say for you. Let me just challenge you. Of course, church attendance doesn't save anybody. But you know, when you miss out. When you're not with God's people, when it's time for them to meet, you miss out. That's what happened to Thomas. But as we get back to it here, you know, think about loneliness. Loneliness only feeds discouragement, which ultimately will grow into self-pity. You've seen it in people's lives. Let me urge you to make a practice of being in church every week, unless, you know, there are some legitimate reasons sometimes for not being here. But let me encourage you to be here with God's people, or if you're a member of another church, to be there when God's people meet. Because that way you won't miss anything. But don't be like Thomas. But you know, Thomas's words help us to differentiate, though, here between, you know, doubt and unbelief. Did you know doubt and unbelief are two different things? A lot of people say it's the same. No. Doubt does not equal unbelief. No. They're different. And we see that here in Thomas's life. You know, he said, what? I cannot believe. until I see, I cannot. You know, there's some. A person who doubts says, you know, I cannot believe. But the week after this, we see here in the scripture, a week later, they were gathered together again, and this time he was there. And it says, even though the doors were locked, Kelly, the doors were locked. It says that Jesus miraculously appeared in that room, and he said this three times. And let me say it today for you, because we all need it. Peace be with you. It's the Hebrew word shalom. Peace be with you. All of us need peace in our hearts, especially in this day in which we live. So three times he says shalom, shalom, shalom. And then, that's in verse 27, Jesus begins to deal with Thomas in a very personal way. And he invites him to deal with his doubts by touching. He said, okay. Yeah. And he said, and this is what Jesus really said literally to him, stop doubting and believe. Stop doubting and believe. You see, Jesus wants to deal with your doubts too. And my doubts. Do I have doubts? Followers, be honest. No matter how strong our faith is, sometimes we have doubts. But doubt is not the same thing as unbelief. Doubt can lead to unbelief, but we see in Thomas's life it didn't. Jesus deals with them, you know. Some people have some very genuine intellectual questions about our faith, folks. Don't turn people away who have questions about our Christian faith. A lot of people have very real, serious doubts. They're legitimate. And if you're here today and you have some, if you're really serious about getting answers, I'll guarantee you the Lord will give you the evidence that you need, if you really are. But you know, some people hide behind their questions. Some people hide behind their doubts when the truth of the matter is that they really have a hard heart and they don't want to believe. But Jesus welcomes Thomas with all of his doubts. Actually, I believe the road to real faith sometimes starts with doubts. You see, faith acts even in the midst of doubt. And that's what we see in Thomas. When Thomas came face to face with the risen Lord Jesus Christ, he made a bold confession. Now, did he stick in there and put his finger? No, he didn't. He had said before, you know, I will not, unless I can touch it and see it, I'm not. But the Bible doesn't say he did that. The Bible says as soon as he saw the risen Lord, he fell on his knees and he said, my Lord. And my God. And he worshiped Jesus. You see. His doubts were defeated by faith. He was so amazed that he didn't have to put his finger into the wounds. Instead, he just worshiped the Lord. You see, Jesus Christ came to die to make a full payment for your sin and my sin. And the fact that the resurrection is true, validates all the claims of Jesus Christ. It verifies that he conquered sin. It was who he was, who he said he was. He conquered sin. He conquered Satan. He conquered death. Oh, death, where is thy sting? Oh, grave, where is your victory? Jesus defeated it all. He rose from the dead. He's alive forevermore. He's risen. Y'all awake? He's risen indeed, yes. So the disciples had the privilege of seeing Jesus with their own eyes. But you know, it wasn't their seeing Jesus that saved them, Brother Jim. It was their believing. Verse 29. Jesus said to Thomas, Thomas, because you have seen me, you've believed. Brothers and sisters, read that next verse, next sentence. Blessed are those who have not seen and yet believed. We've not seen Jesus, but we believe. Jesus said we're blessed. You haven't seen Jesus physically, but you believed in him. You're blessed today. You're blessed. Well, if you've put your faith in Jesus Christ today, let me tell you, you're saved. And did you know you're saved forever? You've believed without seeing. That's why Easter is amazing. Somebody say Easter is amazing. It is. The resurrection ought to make us run. We ought to be so truly amazed that we take action today, that we follow the Lord. You know, Mark 9:15 talks about that. It says immediately. It says immediately when they saw him, all the people were greatly amazed and running to him, greeting him. This was Jesus. This is the kind of response that he needs. Let me just close by saying, you know, this morning in this crowd of people here, praise God that you're here. This is the fullest we've been in a while. Of course, it's Easter Sunday, but there's two different groups of people here today. There are those who have not yet believed. I believe there's somebody here. And there's those who believe. That's it. There's some that haven't believed. There's some that have believed. And if you have not believed, let me just urge you today to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ and to receive him as your Savior. Easter is amazing. And let me just tell you that to believe involves facts. It involves feelings, but ultimately it involves faith. Faith in the Lord. It is rational, though. Our faith is not irrational. A lot of people are trying to tell us it's irrational. No, it's rational. It has. We have facts. We have facts backing it up. But you know, even though, you know, it's not just enough to know the facts or the truth. And it's not just enough to feel some emotions about them. A person has to, by their will, make a decision to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. The word believe literally means to cling to rely on, to trust in. In other words, I think this is the best illustration I've ever heard before is, okay, I believe that this chair is strong enough to hold me. You know, that's not really enough, though, to prove it, right? The only way that I can really believe and prove that this chair will hold me if I sit there is what? I have to go and sit in it. And that's the same thing with Jesus, folks. If you haven't received Jesus, let me urge you on this Easter Sunday. It's simple. It's not easy. You've heard me say this many times. Not easy, but it's simple. All it is, you say, God, I know I'm a sinner. Can't save myself. Someday I'm going to die for my sins. But thank you, Jesus. I acknowledge the fact that, Jesus, you came and you died for my sins. You paid the price for my sins. And on that third day, you rose from the dead. And I repent of my sin. I turn from my sin. That's what it means to repent. Turn from my sin and myself. And I turn to you, Jesus. And I say, Jesus, save me. Come into my life. I repent of my sins. I trust in Jesus. What he did on that cross. That simple. And if you already have believed and received, let me tell you. You know what we need to do? Go and tell. That's what. Go and tell. Run and tell. Go. Be active, sharing your faith with other people. I tell you, people need to hear the hope of Jesus Christ today. So many people. Let's all stand. We're going to sing a hymn. The choir is going to come up, sing for us, or sing with us. Just As I Am, it's a different version of Just I Am, but it's a beautiful song, and it's a great invitation song. If you're here today and you've never put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ, we encourage you to make that profession of faith today, or come, and if you're not clear about it, we'll share with you. If you're here and God's leading you to become a part of fellowship, we invite you to do that as well. Or if there's some other decision you need to make, we need prayer today, you just may need to kneel here in the altar and deal something in your life with the Lord. He's here. And as we sing, you come.